This video is about the first chapter of novels. It's part of a series of seminar-like YouTube videos, an idea by Robert Jones, the story detective, and you will find the other entries for this particular topic, first chapters, in the description below, at least as soon as I get the links from the other authors. In my video, we look at five different books from different times and their first chapters. And they couldn't be more different. It's The Fault in Our Stars, Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone, Starship Troopers, It, The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, and Pride and Prejudice. Yeah, I know I'm comparing apples to oranges, but you totally can compare apples and oranges. Both are fruits, both can be sweet and sour, and if you're an apple and your skin is less smooth than that of an orange, you really should focus more on your skincare. So we've got romance, we've got young adult, we've got sci-fi, we've got mystery, we've got detective story, we've got horror, we've got first-person narrator, we've got third-person narrator. The only thing these novels have in common is that they are all written in the past tense. That's it. They are not even written in the same millennium. Please keep in mind that you can't compare the poor numbers, the poor percentages. You have to pay your regards to the tone of voice, the time, the type of novel. But we will do our best to look at them and maybe learn something from them. Let's get started.
This is my spreadsheet for analyzing chapters. It focuses on sentence starters. It has a bit of function for if it's normal text, dialogue, a dialogue tag, or an action tag. And you can look at the sentence length. At last, I inserted a word count for the chapter. For the six novels I mentioned previously, I already inserted the first chapters in the spreadsheet with this function, then automatically analyzed it, did a bit of manual stuff, and generated the statistics for it. I ordered the books according to their publishing date, with the newest book, Fault in Our Stars, on the left hand, and the oldest book, Pride and Prejudice, on the right hand. You see, we've got nearly 200 years between the newest and the oldest, so we've got quite a spread. Then I colored the winner of the line with the highest percentage in yellow and the lowest percentage of the line in blue. I believe it's extraordinary, but it might be incidentally that you've got an amalgamation of colored on the far ends of the spectrum with the oldest and the newest book. Let's look at the first sentences of the books first, and the last sentence of the first chapter. Thanks to this tool, I realized that they're pretty interesting as well. We start with Pride and Prejudice. First sentence. It is a truth universally acknowledged that a single man in possession of good fortune must be in want of a wife. So, quite a statement, and the statement sums up a good part of the book. We know immediately, okay, this book is about catching wives, finding marriage. Let's look at the last sentence. The business of her life was to get her daughters married. Its solace was visiting in youth. We go from the abstract statement of the first sentence to the concrete statement of the last sentence. Next, Sherlock Holmes. To Sherlock Holmes, she is always the woman. I mean, this sentence is mysterious and fascinating. We don't know yet who is Sherlock Holmes. And then there is this mysterious she, and she's always the woman. So quite the enticing first sentence. The last sentence is, if you will be good enough to call tomorrow afternoon at 3 o'clock, I should like to chat this little matter over with you. Yeah, not very impressive, but you have to account for that the Sherlock Holmes book is a short story book, so maybe there isn't that much emphasis on the first chapter because the story arc is relatively short, or it might be he just didn't care. Next, Starship Troopers. The first chapter starts with a quote. It's, come on, you apes, you want to live forever. Great quote, because you think immediately, ah, you want to live forever, do I want to live forever? And what are the persons who have to ask themselves these kind of questions? Very powerful. And I like the real first sentence as well. I always get the shakes before the drop. Because we have a little mystery there as well. We've got something called a drop. We don't know what it is yet. We've got someone who gets the shakes. So he's shaking. He's afraid of the drop. Great, great, great. If you want to know more about my analysis of Starship Troopers, the first chapter, I've got a video series on it. It's called Ninja Hen vs. Copycat. And we go more in details about this book. Let's look at the last sentence. Flores died on the way up. You don't see immediately why this sentence is so awesome. You have to know a bit more of the context of the book. The last several hundred or thousand words, they were busy with saving Flora's life and risking the lives of the whole outfit for it. And then the first person narrator, he speaks about this starship captain and that she's a good pilot. Yeah, he spends several words and sentences, around 7, to praise her. And then there comes the bomb. Just one short sentence. Flores died on the way up. This sentence hammered home the tragedy of war more than some whole paragraphs I've read. Very powerful. Next book. It. First sentence. The terror, which would not end for another 28 years, if it ever did, began, so far as I know or can tell, with a boat made from a sheet of newspaper floating down a gutter swollen with rain. We've got a strong first sentence here as well. The book starts with the two words, the terror, and ends with an image of a boat floating down a gutter. Very interesting is that the chapter ends with the same picture of the boat. All I know is that it was still afloat and still running on the breast of the flood when it passed the incorporated town limits of Derry, Maine, and there it passes out of this tale forever. So we've got a bridge spanning from the first sentence to the last sentence of the first chapter. This is one of the concepts you can apply for first chapters, that you make it like a little mirror of the whole book and connecting the first and the last chapter in a circle is kind of an elegant way to round it up. Next book, Harry Potter. Mr. and Mrs. Dursley of number 4 Privet Drive were proud to say that they were perfectly normal. Thank you very much. This sentence has not much to do with the rest of the book, which is kind of interesting because the other first sentences very much pointed at the core of the respective books. This is also the case with The Stars Beyond Our Fall, but this, or maybe the core of the first Harry Potter book is that it's not about a perfectly normal world. I don't know, I don't want to overinterpret it, but the last sentence is pretty interesting. To Harry Potter, the boy who lived. And when I read this, more specifically when I reread this, there were fanfares going off in my head. To Harry Potter, the boy who lived. Very powerful to end the first chapter like this. Let's look at our last book, or our first book. The first chapter is, late in the winter of my 17th year, my mother decided I was depressed. Presumably because I rarely left the house, spent quite a lot of time in bed, read the same book over and over, ate infrequently, and devoted quite a bit of my abundant free time to thinking about death. Great first sentence as well. We've got a kind of summary of this book right in the first paragraph. The main topics are there as well. It's obviously about a teenager in a difficult time of their life. Okay, maybe all teenagers are in a difficult time of their life, but this seemed to be a bit more than the usual teenage angst. The last sentence is, please record the next several episodes of the ANTM marathon for me. Yeah. I have to admit, this is the most disappointing last sentence. But the first sentence was really good. So, let's go back to our statistics. Let's look at what kind of text these chapters include. Pride and Prejudice has the least amount of normal text. A whooping 77% is dialogue. Wow, just wow. Then Sherlock Holmes got a huge percentage of dialogue as well, with 70%, and I'm eager to try another first chapter from this time to see whether it was a common thing that you emphasized the dialogue in the first chapter. Starship Troopers, we've got a good amount of dialogue in the first half of the first chapter, but then it sinks quite rapidly. It has the lowest part of dialogue from all the stories. Then Harry Potter and Fault in Our Stars is around the 40% mark. Through The Fault in Our Stars has not much dialogue, it had the most amount of classical dialogue text. And I really attribute this to the modern style of writing. They emphasize that it's totally okay to write classical dialogue text like he said, she said. The least amount of dialogue text has Starship Troopers. There are more action texts, but the huge amount of dialogue is delivered in one sentence. There's a very long dialogue of an officer who chides his troop or motivates his troop. You never can be too sure with the army. Pride and Prejudice has for its nearly 80% a very low amount of dialogue text as well. And it is not substituted by action tags. You have to kind of guess who's speaking at the moment. I believe we came a long way to make it more clear who is speaking authors nowadays are more recognizant of the fact that readers sometimes confuse it and are trying to make it more clear, is my impression, not only from this few books, but from all of my reading. The manual analyses are dialogue tags my algorithm don't catches, or like action-like dialogue text, like he shrugged, describing the action the people do after they spoke. So we've got here a clear preference of normal dialogue text in the more modern version. The difference in percentages grew lesser with It and Starship Troopers. Sherlock Holmes, it's roughly the same in Harry Potter, and Pride and Prejudice has a very low difference. I believe you can see a bit of tendency over the time to go more in the direction of dialogue text, but it could be purely coincidental because our sample size is so little. I won't repeat this in the future of this video. The sample size is very small. All tendencies we can abstract from it or conclude from it might be purely incidental. Next, we look at the bottom of the page to the word count. Pride and Prejudice is the shortest chapter by far, with a bit over 1,000 words. Sherlock Holmes has 3,500. Starship Troopers, 7,000. It was so big that it didn't fit in one Excel cell, so I had to split the analysis. It is big with over 5,000 words as well, but the first chapter was split into under chapters, I believe 5 or 6 sub-chapters, and I counted them as one chapter. Harry Potter, 4.6k, Fault in Our Stars, 3.7k words. No tendency is visible. Maybe with longer chapters in the middle of the last centuries. I'm used to shorter chapters because I'm in the web novel world, and they're mostly between 2,000, let's say from 1,000 to 3,000 words. I rarely see longer chapters in the web fiction world. Sentence starters. It amazed me how much regular sentence starters the people use. I thought they vary it more. Regular sentence starters are subject, verb, and maybe an object as well. For 1A is Harry played on the street. 1B is did this, that, or these. Yeah, some, most, any, stuff like this. I know that you can use some of these words as conjunctions as well, so it's not that exact category. 1C is you, because I thought this interesting as a kind of style method to engage your reader. But the percentages on this are not relevant because there is so much dialogue in the samples. Let's take a peek on it, our winner in this category. Okay, we've got a lot of sentences here starting with the, a few with a person like Bill and George and he. Dialogues. Now it's very heavy on the he. The clown. And we'll look at Pride and Prejudice with the least amount of regular sentences. This is of course due to the heavy emphasis on dialogue. Okay, we've got a mixture of starters. So 1B, maybe we take a short look as well. Okay, maybe not that short. Not interesting. We skip 1C, the you part, and go to the next sentence starter, where or when. Not only the words where or when, but words concerning the location or the time. The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes is the winner in this category. So we've got some ins, a lot of thens, or a good lot of thens, some theres, some from, here, nows. Let's look at someone who uses this literary device only sparingly. That would be Pride and Prejudice, but it's dialogue heavy and pretty short, so let's look at Harry Potter. Here we've got a good variety of words. Two theres. These two sentences don't count. Maybe I should delete about for this section. So let's look what is the predominant sentence starters beside the regular ones in Harry Potter. That would be conjunctions or connector words. We've got a low amount of where and when, but on the other hand, a high amount of conjunctions. We contrast this with our winner in the where and when section. We've got a very high amount of conjunctions here as well. So you can't say that they use both literary devices, that they interchanged them, at least not comparing these two examples. Let's look at the more unpopular beginnings. That's an in phrase. Harry Potter and it are the only both books with a significant amount of in phrases. Only the first and the last sentence are counting towards the literary device in phrases. The second sentence is a question, and we've got two times shooting stars as a term. I mean, it's called shooting stars and it's not actually an in phrase. And nothing there, my algorithm sucks. I have to adjust it that nothing doesn't count as an in phrase. Let's look at it. Okay, my algorithm sucked here too, with nothing as well. But we've got three actual in phrases. Stuttering Bill never forgets that piece. Telling was only part of it. Sitting up in bed. We skip the two phrases, my algorithm sucks even worse for them, and we haven't got a significant amount of usage. The same goes for the ED phrase. Sentence starters with Lee words. Here the Adventure of Sherlock Holmes rules, but those aren't the Lee words we hate to love and love to hate, but it's the speak pattern of Sherlock Holmes. Like frequently, precisely, absolutely, certainly. So connector words. Connector words are by far the most popular way to start a sentence besides from the regular ones. We haven't looked at Starship Troopers a lot, so let's look at it for this category. Oh yes, I remember. He was a big fan of but sentences. Yeah, the buts and the ends dominated. On the second half as well. Let's look at another one. Let's take The Fault in Our Stars. We've got a lot of ends. And then some spread. Whenever, so, also, furthermore, but, when, so, because, as or like is pretty insignificant. Question or prompts. Of course, Pride and Prejudice rules there as well, because it's so dialogue heavy. The interesting aspect is that there are a lot of exclamation marks. My algorithm only catches exclamation when there is an exclamation mark, and I noticed that many of the more current books They do imperatives, they do prompts, but they leave out the exclamation mark. This might be a difference between German literature and English literature, because when in Germany we write a prompt to someone, we set always an exclamation mark behind it, even when it's not said forcefully. It's pretty interesting when you look at Starship Troopers. There were a lot of prompts who I didn't recognize as prompts because there were no exclamation marks. Here, like, don't buy a farm, don't try to win a medal. I adjusted the algorithm that do and don't will get identified as prompt as well. Otherwise, it wouldn't have caught it. The rest, the bloody rest. These are sentences my algorithm don't know what to do with. It can be totally normal sentence starting with just the word. I have no list of all the subjects, so it can be a totally regular sentence, but I believe it is telling that Pride and Prejudice got least amount and the most current novel got the highest amount, because the old times defined what we see as normal in a sentence and what not. So my ability to program these algorithms is influenced on what I learned in school or what I learned now. And this kind of science is of course based on the classical literature. So in 50 years there might be some more categories of sentence starters, and my algorithm will deal with the fault in our stars. Let's just look at some of the sentences where my algorithm failed. Alright, we see here a lot of things that are specific for this book, like these short sentences just with one word, and then there is a section with kind of teenage dialogue where me and mom, another one of this clearly prompts but without exclamation mark, buy me a fake ID so I can go to clubs, drink vodka and take pot. Dialogue stuff, yes, well, no, not particularly interesting for this kind of topic of sentence starters. As well as dialogue tag structure, like city. Alright, that was it to the sentence starters. Apart from the issues I've mentioned, I don't see any clear point of direction, any specific preferences that developed over the time. I believe it's more dependent on whether you narrate the book in third person or in first person, whether you have much dialogue or little dialogue. What I took from this analysis is the huge amount of regular sentence. Maybe because I'm a beginner author, I thought people would vary it more, people would more when or where, more ing phrases, more connector words, and maybe even a bit of Lee words. Okay, I kind of knew that you shouldn't use Lee words. Interestingly, The Fault in Our Stars uses one of the Lee words that is frowned upon because of different reasons. It's suddenly. First, it's a Lee word, and second, it's also a filtering word. You shouldn't use suddenly because the events are filtered through the narrator and it takes away the experience of the reader. Please let someone else tell you about filtering words. I want to include an algorithm for filtering words and for the undesirable words, like the li words in all positions of the sentence, and of words like really and very, words you shouldn't use or only use sparingly and with mindfulness. The other li words are, yeah, you can disregard the dialogue, and here in this line, literally, it's even a great use for a li word, because it's just such a typical teenager word for those times. So it even has the function of characterizing the speaker. So let's look at the sentence length. Here we have a clear indication of time. I really believe that the sentence are now shorter than in the past. The very big sentence winner is Starship Troopers, but you've got some long sentences in The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes and Pride and Prejudice as well. The really amazingly long sentences are still used even in the current times and even in YA. This astonished me a bit. But it's kind of positive that the authors think even our young readers can understand them. Let's look at the one sentences of Harry Potter. Ah, it's the second last sentence of this chapter. And it's connected by a literary device. We've got a repetition of not knowing he was special, not knowing he was famous, not knowing he would be woken in a few hours of time. Then we got a connection with S, a connection with nor, an and, an ellipsis, a subordinate clause with meeting and holding. Okay. And this really long sentence follows the very short end sentence, to Harry Potter, the boy who lived. Now we look at the main culprit, Starship Troopers. We've got even one mega dialogue. Yeah. We've got a lot of ellipses here as well. This was another point which astonished me, how many ellipses there were in the first chapters. It has a lot as well. Even Pride and Prejudice has them. I noticed it because my program had a problem with differentiating them from normal end of sentence points, the other ellipses. So don't let Grammarly tell you out of your ellipses. Go for it! Another thing, the M dash is used much as well. Alright, folks, this was my video about the first chapters of different books and looking at it from a sentence structure perspective. For content or suggestions about first chapters, please watch the videos of my friends and colleagues of the AuthorTube community. If you're interested in more analyzing with my Excel tool, with my spreadsheet tool, you can watch my series Ninja Hen vs. Copycat, analyzing and copying books. I will further develop this spreadsheet. I use it to analyze the chapters of my novels as well, and I learned quite a bit by it. I can catch repetitions in phrasing much easier than by just reading the chapter. So thank you for watching. Please comment on it and please suggest if you have an idea to any possible features for my spreadsheet. I'm thankful for inspirations for it. Bye bye.